Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture on hyperemesis gravidarum. So what is hyperemesis gravidarum? It is persistent or increased vomiting in pregnancy, increased or severe vomiting in pregnancy. Generally in pregnancy, many women has vomiting. Having vomiting is quite common and it is physiological in pregnancy. Then when is it called hypergravidarum? Whenever the mother has severe vomiting and the mother has weight loss of more than 5% of pre-pregnancy weight. If the weight is more than 5% of pre-pregnancy weight, or if the mother has dehydration and if the mother has ketonuria, then we call it as hyperemesis gravidarum. Okay. Whenever there is vomiting, what happens? Vomiting leads to loss of potassium and HCl is lost. So because potassium and HCl is lost, this causes decreased potassium, that is hypokalemia can occur. And also because of decreased HCl, there can be hypochloremic. Because H, that is hydrogen ions are lost, it can lead to alkalosis. So this is what we have. Happens hypokalemia or hypokalemic hypochloremic alkalosis occurs in pregnancy whenever there is hyperemesis gravidarum. So what are the risk factors? The first risk factor is primi gravida, first pregnancy, and the next younger age. And there are two things which are based on hormones. One is hydatidiform or molar pregnancy, or if there is multifetal pregnancy. In multifetal pregnancy, everything doubles. So even in molar pregnancy, there is increased HCG. In both these conditions, there is increased HCG. So because of the increased HCG, this causes increased vomiting, or there is increased vomiting, and thus it can lead to hyperemesis gravidarum, because HCG is the main hormone which is responsible for vomiting sensation or nausea sensation in pregnancy. Then you'll have to also look after past history. What are the past history? If the mother has motion sickness, or if she has migraine in the normally, or if she has hyperemesis in previous pregnancy, even then there is an increased chance of hyperemesis gravidarum, and female fetus is also increased chance. So these are the increased past history which we have to look into. Okay, now why is there vomiting? What is the hormonal changes that happens? One, there is, why is there vomiting in pregnancy? Number one, it is hormonal changes. Hormonal changes are estrogen, progesterone. These are increased in pregnancy, number one. And then beta HCG hormone is also increased, that too more commonly in first trimester of pregnancy. Okay. And then in the first trimester, there is also increased T4 and also increased TSH occurs. Okay, all these will contribute to hyperemesis gravidarum. Okay, then there is also second factor, which is gastrointestinal dysfunction. So in gastrointestinal dysfunction, there can be GERD, because mainly the progesterone. Okay, this progesterone causes gastric dysmotility. Okay, gastric dysmotility. And there is also in the pregnancy abnormal vagal tone and sympathetic tone. Normally this vagal and sympathetic, this should be equal, or they should, you know, they should compensate each other. But because of this abnormality, there is relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter, and this results in reflux and thus causing vomiting. Okay, and there is also one more history where there is hepatic dysfunction. Whenever there is hepatic dysfunction Even then, there is a chance of vomiting, and during this time, there is increased serum transaminases have been seen. Okay? Sometimes, this is one more cause, and then sometimes infection. In the infection, most commonly, Helicobacter pylori infection. Even this causes vomiting or hyperemesis gravidarum. Okay? And there is one more cause, which is familial. That is family history. If there is family history of hyperemesis gravidarum in the family, then obviously the mother will have hyperemesis gravidarum. So these are the different factors which will affect hyperemesis, which will cause hyperemesis gravidarum. Sometimes some olfactory stimuli like strong smells, perfumes, all these can also cause hyperemesis. Okay. Now, what are the complications that you see in hyperemesis gravidarum? So, complications. Okay. Complications. What are the complications? As I have already said, there is... There is vomiting. So there is decreased. So loss of, number one, loss of chloride, loss of potassium, loss of HCl, okay, loss of potassium. And there is also decreased appetite, right? Because of decreased appetite, there can be thiamine deficiency. Or there can be vitamin K deficiency. So because of this HCl and potassium loss, there can be hypokalemic. I have already said this. Hypokalemic, hypochloremic, because chlorine is also lost. And there can be metabolic or alkalosis. Better to say hyperkalemic alkalosis is there. And then because of this vomiting, violent vomiting, whenever there is severe violent vomiting, there can be Mallory V stairs, which we learnt in surgery. Okay. And because of this vomiting, there is loss of water. Because of loss of water, there can be dehydration. So this dehydration can lead to hypovolemia. And this can in turn lead to renal failure, that to pre-renal type of renal failure. Okay, acute renal failure can occur. So these are the different complications which we see in hyperemesis gravidarum. So what are the clinical features that we see in hyperemesis gravidarum? It's simple. There will be nausea. The best clinical feature is there will be nausea. So vomiting. These nausea and vomiting will be more than 3 times per day. Nausea will be there and vomiting will be there. And these will be more than 3 times per day. Okay. When do they begin normally? They will begin at 5 to 6 weeks and peaks by 8 to 9 weeks and resolves by 12 to 14 weeks. They start by 5 to 6 weeks and they peak by 8 to 9 weeks and they resolve by 12 to 14 weeks. Okay. So this is how it starts. And because of that, there is weight loss. The weight loss is more than 5%, that is equal to more than 3 kgs. There can be orthostatic hypotension because of hypovolemia. Okay, so these are the clinical features which are seen. So, how are you going to diagnose? Diagnosis is just by investigations. You can look for serum electrolytes. Serum electrolytes, because there is hypokalemic, hypochloremic alkalosis can be there. So you'll have to look after serum electrolytes and you'll have to see about urine for ketone bodies. And ultrasonography should be done. Why? To rule out multifetal pregnancy or hydrated mole. Okay. And if it is very severe, then you'll have to do creatinine study, thyroid study to rule out renal function tests, or you'll have to do renal failure should be ruled out, and you'll have to rule out hepatic dysfunction, so you'll have to do liver function tests. And what is the management? Management, first, diet. The main important thing is diet. In the diet, you'll have to ask the mother to eat small meals. Fluids should be taken adequately. And also, we should ask to avoid the triggering factors. If mother feels nauseating with some smell or oil or tea or some other things, then we'll have to ask her to avoid it. Okay? And then, you'll have to counsel her. And if one, if even then it does not subside, then you can start for medical treatment. Medical treatment is by pyridoxin should be given. That is 10 milligrams plus doxylamine should be given 10 milligrams. Okay. Now, if potassium is low, then transfuse potassium. Give or transfuse or give additional potassium. All fluids should be replaced. Fluids and electrolytes should be replaced. And you should also give thiamine IV, because there is a chance of thiamine deficiency. 100 milligrams is given. And if we want, we can give dextrose also. And vitamin B12 can also be given if necessary. So these are the different treatment options which are available for hyperemesis gravidarum. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. In my next class, we will learn about the post-dated pregnancy or post-term pregnancy. So thank you for watching my lecture. I think you have understood the hyperemesis gravidarum. At least you have got some concepts. So thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.